Hi, my name is Dr. Davina Kotulski, and I'm a licensed clinical psychologist. I have a private practice in the Pasadena, Los Angeles area, and I have a specialty working with LGBT people and their families around coming out issues and addressing the specific issues that come up with LGBT people because of the inequities and discrimination that LGBT people experience. Have you ever had any of these challenges as a therapist? Have you found that you don't know which words to use when speaking to an LGBT or a non-binary client? Perhaps you're afraid that you might offend your client by using the wrong language. Are you confused or overwhelmed by the alphabet of terms like LGBTIQA and not really know or aren't clear on what they stand for? Perhaps you believe that LGBT people should work specifically with an LGBT therapist as opposed to a non-LGBT therapist. In this course, you're going to learn all the terminology that you need to know when working with LGBTIQ people, and what words to use and what words to steer clear of. Now, even well-meaning therapists can make mistakes. Having a caring, well-meaning therapist is the most important part. However, it's not enough. As many minority groups know, even a well-meaning therapist can make mistakes if they're not educated about the important situations that this minority group faces. It's extremely important that therapists not make assumptions and attribute every psychological issue to minority group status, which, you know, in this situation is being LGBT. It's equally important that therapists not underestimate the impact of being LGBT and how discrimination and the social context in which an LGBT person lives impacts the psychological experience of the LGBT person in the world. Minimizing the impact of bullying or discrimination or oppression can actually hurt a client. It's important that a therapist be able to look at the situation a client is facing and to identify what the specific stressors are that an LGBT person is experiencing because of their minority status and discrimination, and what things have nothing to do with LGBT status and have to do with other psychological or social stressors. In other words, many LGBT people have experienced in therapy, they found that their therapists just want to focus on their being LGBT and seeing that as the problem. It's important that the exclusive focus, that not be the exclusive focus on therapy. Sometimes clients experience that therapists who don't have enough experience working with LGBT people may come across like voyeurs. And certainly I've had clients report that that's what they've experienced when working with undereducated or uneducated therapists who are not a part of the LGBT community. Personally, in my own therapy, I've had that experience where therapists are using my time that I'm paying them to educate themselves and to pique their curiosity and satisfy their own curiosity about LGBT people rather than focusing on the clinical issues at hand. Again, it's important that therapists understand each client's specific experiences. There's a difference between getting to know a client and to know their specific worldviews and experiences and using that client to glean information and to educate themselves. Therapists need to educate themselves outside of the client hour about the needs of the population they work with. Additionally, it was not uncommon in the past for heterosexual therapists or non-LGBT therapists to attribute pathology to the reason why a client would be LGBT. The myth that clients are gay because they experience sexual trauma in childhood are myths that continue to be perpetuated in some situations, and so those must be addressed as well. It's important that the clinician educate themselves about LGBT terminology and the reality that LGBT people face while being able to be completely present with their clients and the specific issues that their clients are bringing up in the sessions during their therapeutic hour. And that's what you're going to get with my course. In my course, you're going to learn or refamiliarize yourself with the correct terminology, which is ever evolving. You're also going to look at the current and socio-political issues that LGBT people face and their families face, as well as the historical context that LGBT people have grown up in, essentially. We'll look at the history of discrimination in the LGBT community, both with regard to the therapeutic community and the general community. As you may know, it wasn't until 1973 that the American Psychiatric Association removed homosexuality as a DSM category. Additionally, it wasn't until 2003 that same-sex relations were no longer criminalized in the United States. Up until 2003, when the United States Supreme Court ruled in the Lawrence v. Texas decision, Members of a same-sex couple in a relationship could be thrown in prison, literally taken out of their home for the expression of love and affection that was taking place in the privacy of their own home, and thrown into jail because same-sex sexual behavior was considered a crime in several states up until 2003. Again, the Lawrence v. Texas decision in 2003 struck down all remaining bans on same-sex behavior. Also in this course, you're going to learn about the unique stressors that face LGBT people and their family and how to support them through that. You're going to learn about vulnerable members of the LGBT population, such as youth and seniors, and how to anticipate their specific mental health needs. You're also going to learn about the coming out stages in Vivian Cass's identity model. In this course, I'm going to share with you important do's and don'ts when working with LGBT clients. For example, you do want to ask the client what specific terms they use when referring to themselves rather than making assumptions. That includes gender identity, pronouns, and sexual orientation, and sexual attraction. In other words, you may have a female client who is currently attracted to another woman. You wouldn't want to make the assumption that she identifies as lesbian. She may use the word gay, she may identify as bisexual, she may identify as pansexual, omnisexual, or demisexual. She may identify as heterosexual and having a relationship with a woman. She also may identify as a straight man attracted to a woman. So you really want to know from the client how they identify, and not only what their sexual orientation is, but what their gender identity is. And those things are separate. And so you want to ask them what their preferred pronouns are. We'll talk more about that. You'll learn the difference again between gender orientation and sexual orientation, which people often confuse and link together. So don'ts, again, you don't want to assume what someone's sexual orientation is or their gender identity or their pronouns simply based on their presentation. You don't want to assume that everyone is heterosexual or cisgendered. Again, when you're doing your intakes with a new client, asking more general questions such as, are you married? What does your husband or wife do? In your recent relationships, do you date men or women? What are your preferred pronouns? Are you attracted to both men and women, or one or the other, or both? Or are you demisexual or pansexual? You want to ask broader questions. Many clients may feel intimidated sharing who they are with you. If you set the stage that you're open and you understand that heterosexuality is not the only sexuality nor the superior sexuality, then clients will be more forthcoming with you and are more likely to share their experiences. At the end of this course, again, you're going to know the stages of coming out and identify the correct language to use when referring to or speaking with LGBT people. You're going to have a better idea of the general psychological issues that your LGBT clients may face, and you're going to understand the history of discrimination that the LGBT population has faced. Even though there is not a linear, genetic, intergenerational transmission of trauma, each new group that comes out, each new generation of LGBT people, is still inheriting the past homophobia and heterosexism of the culture. And there's still a lot of shifting going on. While we live in a much better time period, being gay is no longer a mental health issue in this country. It's no longer a crime in this country. However, there are still people who believe that being LGBT is a sin, or at the very least, a birth defect, somehow inferior, and that heterosexuality is superior. So this course is really designed to familiarize you with the issues LGBT people face, and to be a therapist who is welcoming, who has a basic education about LGBT issues, and is going to be able to help their LGBT clients. I hope you enjoy this course, and I want to thank you for taking it. Have a great day.